The much-anticipated address by Prime Minister Narendra Modi lasted almost exactly half an hour, which was spent mostly reassuring the country about the fact that it is a difficult time, but that we will have to show resolve to get through this difficult time. As he put it, sankalm and sayam, resolve and restraint. But in terms of actually concrete announcements, the most significant one that the Prime Minister made was the fact that he declared Sunday as a day of what he called Janata curfew, where from the morning till night, he said, people should stay off the streets and remain as far as possible in their homes because of the importance of social distancing, a phrase which has been widely circulated in the context of the virus and which he used himself in a speech, and said, barring essential services, almost everybody else should limit themselves to their homes. Now, whether he's asking for this as a form of self-discipline or whether this will be legally enforced or enforced by the state is something that's not entirely clear. But the big announcement, in a sense, from this speech was a one-day, effectively a one-day lockdown on Sunday from morning till night. And he said that at some point in the course of the day, the evening, in fact, at 5 o'clock, that everyone should come out on their balconies and publicly recognize the work of all those who have actually served during this time. Importantly, he also said that the government is closely monitoring the situation and that there was no need to panic and that there's no need for any kind of panic buying or any kind of hoarding, which is being reported in some cases. He said all supply lines are open and are being maintained, so please continue to buy and stock for this particular time as you would in normal times. So that was the Prime Minister there in his first ever address on the coronavirus. Okay, let's just start getting in some reactions now from our panel. We have Dr. Srinath Reddy with us. Dr. K. Srinath Reddy, President, Public Health Foundation. Thank you very much indeed, Dr. Reddy, for joining us. If I can just start off with you and just get your first thoughts about what the Prime Minister said.
I think the Prime Minister has emphasized the need for public participation in this whole effort to resist the corona epidemic by becoming part of the movement, not just looking at it as a government responsibility, but as a popular movement in order to overcome this threat. He actually also has called for the people not to overload the health services with routine demands,
right,
so that the hospitals can actually devote their time to the care of the corona patients, the COVID patients, and that's a very important measure. And also, while appealing that we should not be panicking,
yes,
I think it's a very important measure of bringing solidarity between the community and the caregivers, which we have not seen in the recent past, where there have been attacks on hospitals by angry patients and families. I think all of this is essentially to build that sense of solidarity that we are all in it together, and then we need to move in. One other element that I appreciated is the assurance that all essential supplies would be maintained to people,
yes,
without having any difficulty or even the need to hoard. But I believe there should be a special effort when we are asking people to stay at home and try and work from home,
yes,
that some of the daily wage laborers who are dependent on their wages,
yes,
should be looked after, and if necessary, a supply should be provided to them, like in the case of natural disasters, so that no poor family of a daily wage laborer would suffer. But I think this has been a very sensitive speech, looking at a variety of needs of the community,
mm-hmm,
and exhorting the community to become part of the whole effort to resist this threat.
Right. No, I think that's a very important point you made, Dr. Reddy, that essentially this was, in a sense, an appeal for public participation, that this is really not, as some had expected, the Prime Minister setting out a series of measures that the government would announce to tackle the crisis. Those announcements are actually coming as a matter of course, but this was really, as you said, to try and get citizens involved and also make them responsible and aware, as he said. If you think you can just walk around on the streets normally and go to markets, That's not okay. You're actually endangering not just yourself, but also your family and relatives. But I want to just ask you specifically on the idea of this day-long Janata curfew that he spoke of. Is this something which you think is going to be effective, given that this is just for the one day? And also, did you get a sense that he was asking for this as something that people should practice voluntarily? Or do you think that the state will, in a sense, enforce this?
Well, he is asking people to practice voluntarily, but I'm sure there will be people monitoring this from the various official agencies, mm-hmm. including the police. And we will probably be asked to try and observe it.
Right.
But I think the principal element is asking for people's solidarity in this whole effort.
Yeah.
And it is only for a one day to begin with, but possibly if the outbreak or epidemic escalates,
right.
this might become a more routine feature. I thought it was very interesting that he brought in the whole area of blackouts during the war period and
yes.
how you have to have routine practice drills
yes.
so that when the emergency arises, you're ready for it on a long period.
Yeah.
Maybe this is a practice drill, but certainly it's helpful to bring about that element of community solidarity.
Right, because it's true that he did say that I want 2 weeks from you. He said, "Mujhe do hafte aapke chahiye. I want 2 weeks from you," indicating that he might be
yes.
suggesting measures that actually last much longer. But in the end, he limited it to just one day at the moment. But as you said, this could be a practice drill, perhaps building up to other such announcements going down the line. We're also joined by Dr. V.K. Paul, who's member Niti Aayog Health. Chairman of the Board of Governors of Medical Council of India. Also, Vivek Reddy of the BJP, of course, is with us. I'll come to you, Dr. Paul, in just a second. On the phone line, I have with me Kiran Majumdar Shaw from Bangalore, CMD Biocon Limited. Kiran Shaw, your first responses to the Prime Minister's address.
Well, I think as Dr. Reddy just very aptly described it, it was a clarion call for the citizens to really come together and fight this enemy. And he basically also talked about setting up an economic response task force, because he did also, apart from all the things that Dr. Reddy described, which I
yes.
don't want to repeat, he did say that, this is going to have an enormous impact on our economy, and it is going to impact every strata of our society. And therefore, he made a fervent appeal
mm-hmm.
For employers to see how they can look after their employees. He made a fervent appeal to, all the, the way we are going to compensate for our, employees in who are going to be not able to, perform their work on a normal basis.
Right.
And of course, setting up a task force, which he mentioned, will actually look at every aspect of how to basically compensate for this very serious economic impact, which will be chaired by the finance minister. So I think that was also trying to, sort of give assurance
yes.
To the working class that their interests will be looked after. Businesses which will get impacted, and they are saying that they will try and see what they can do to
mm-hmm.
lessen the blow and so on and so forth. So I think he has basically, alerted the citizens of the country that this is a very, very difficult war to fight.
Yeah.
But we all have to come together. And, this self-curfew is also, as Dr. Reddy said, it's like, testing us to see if we are really going to be disciplined enough to understand the gravity of what we are up against.
Right. No, I think that's an important point you made about the economic task force. That's something which came towards the end of the speech, but that's crucial because, as the Prime Minister was indicating, this is going to have an impact on the economy, and many governments around the world are actually committing billions of dollars as stimulus. So we'll have to see what exactly this task force entails, and I'll come back to that with you, Kiran Shaw, in a second, but let me just go across to Dr. V.K. Paul. Dr. Paul, thank you for being with us. Again, just your first thoughts on the Prime Minister's speech, Particularly, I think, Dr. Paul, a lot of people would still be curious about this Janata curfew because that has immediate practical implications for them. Are you getting a sense of this is something which is at the moment more of a voluntary exercise? And also the practical questions, because if you are going to have a complete lockdown for a day, how is that going to work in terms of basic needs, food, other requirements, people moving around, for their essential requirements? So these are all, I think, questions which might require a little bit of clarity.
First and foremost, I think the nation should appreciate that with the address of the Honorable Prime Minister, the country has moved to a very different and a higher level of preparedness. It is a move toward a much more comprehensive response, responding to the way the epidemic, the global pandemic has been shaping up in other countries and drawing lessons from there.
Right.
So first is that we are now in a different stage of our determination and different stage of our action. Secondly, what the Honorable Prime Minister has communicated to the people of India as an elder is the core principles of saving ourselves from a spread for which we don't have a cure,
right.
We don't have a vaccine as of now,
mm-hmm.
and the fundamental principles of disease prevention, which means apne ko bachao, dusron ko bachao, vishwa ko bachao, desh ko bachao strategy has been laid out. Mm. And truly, there are two facets to the social distancing dimension that the Honorable Prime Minister has taken to a totally different level.
Yeah.
One is a generic advice that he has given.
Yes.
In regard to gatherings, in regard to travel,
yes.
in regard to elderly, not to come out of the homes in any case. And then there is a very specific mass movement, community participation model he has presented to us,
yeah.
Namely the Janata curfew, on which for a period of 14 hours, we will all stay at homes. We will show our determination that we are ready for a discipline of that level.
Right.
We are ready to do it for ourselves as well as for our fellow citizens. And it will test our resolve that our services run during that period.
Okay.
Essential services are not affected and so on.
Now, okay.
It is meant to be voluntary. I think very important part is it is an
it's a voluntary, yes.
To demonstrate this on a voluntary basis.
It's
today,
voluntary
it is a voluntary approach.
Yeah. And also, as he said,
yes.
that don't necessarily panic and start hoarding, because there's been a lot of instances where we've come across, particularly in cities, of people hoarding and overstocking. So he said, don't worry about that. The supply lines are all normal and will continue. Vivek Reddy, just to ask you, though, that, of course, it's very important to have heard from the Prime Minister just to begin with, because in a sense, then it reassures the nation that this is being monitored and kind of looked at the highest level. Also, as everyone on the panel has said, his idea to engage with citizens, a very good idea, make it into something which is much more dynamic rather than just announce a series of instructions. But Vivek, there are several questions, though, about how exactly this is playing out in India. And at the moment, touch wood, the numbers are still low compared to the rest of the world. But there are questions about whether is that realistic? Are we testing enough? Do we really know the scale and the extent of the problem? Now, these may not necessarily be things that the Prime Minister needed to address, but they still remain questions.
Well, I think, Vasu, first of all, this has been a sensitizing exercise of the Prime Minister. If we look at the background in other nations, I think the Prime Minister has struck a chord with the people of India at the right time.
Right.
Because we have to prevent a stage 3 community outbreak.
Right.
In view of this, the Prime Minister personally standing up and sensitizing the people and assuring the people, I think this was very important in the exercise. The government is taking all measures. The government assures the citizens of our country that first of all, the supply lines will be maintained. Secondly, everything is being done to control the outbreak. I think it was very important at this stage, Vasu, particularly, because prevention of community outbreak is at
that's
hands
true.
Of citizens
I
also.
I think that was the key.
Yes.
But let me just ask, ask Dr. Reddy, and then I'll go to the same question, Dr. Paul, that Dr. Paul, as I mentioned, that there were several aspects of, in a sense, the actual practical manner in which this disease has to be tackled beyond, of course, social distancing. And one of them, of course, has to do with this whole question of testing and whether India is testing enough. Now, we know that ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research, which is overseeing this, has said that we are not at the moment testing anyone who is not directly affected by the virus. And we've now started to do some surveillance testing, some, in a sense, sampling. Most of those have come out negative, but that pool is very small, some are saying. It's only about 800 to 900. So is there a valid concern about whether we fully understand the extent of the virus in India? And is that something which the government does need to step up a bit? Dr. Reddy, Srinath Reddy. Srinath Reddy, can you hear me?
Okay.
Yes,
that
was a question.
Yeah,
to you.
I can hear you. I thought you were asking Dr. Paul, therefore, okay. I believe that we have to differentiate between different types of testing and the purposes of testing. Firstly, there is testing to find out whether a person with significant symptoms has the disease, and that is based on a clinical assessment of who is likely to have a high probability, and the test should be done in those cases, certainly. Second is to find out the extent of spread and whether it's spilling in the community and spreading. That is a community surveillance type of testing, which involves a community random sampling, which is a part of the surveillance. That certainly needs to be stepped up in order to find out if there is a community spread.
Right.
But if we are going to have a large number of people flooding hospitals because they suspect that they may have some minor symptoms and they're apprehensive about, that's not going to be very productive testing.
Okay.
So we must differentiate the purposes of testing for diagnosis and risk stratification, as well as for identifying what the community surveillance tells us about the potential spread in the community.
Okay.
And both of them require different strategies, and I think that's being stepped up now.
Dr. Paul, would you agree with that? Dr. Paul, just in simple terms,
essentially,
to just explain to the ordinary viewer that is the fact that the virus still seems to be contained in India, are the numbers realistic, or how would you address this concern that the numbers may be much higher but we don't know because we're not testing enough?
So 2 points. Firstly, I do fully agree with Dr. Reddy that there are two different purposes of mounting testing in the population. The part which relates to surveillance, we must not forget that there is a parallel system also working in tandem with the ICMR's own studies, and that relates to our integrated disease surveillance program, monitored and run by the National Center for Disease Control, the NCDC.
Right.
Now, this institution and its research network and surveillance network is also watching the clusters where the patients have been.
Right.
And at any given time, there are more than 50,000 individuals who are under watch, and they are also being tracked and tested as appropriate. So we are gathering intelligence from that direction for the purpose of surveillance as well. And that's not a small sample size in terms of our approach to see where the infection level is.
Right.
Your second, and therefore, a balance of how we should go appears to the scientific community of our nation to be the way forward as of today. The strategy would change if we move to a different state of our assessment.
Okay.
Now, the second point is, are the numbers accurate or not?
Yes.
The way we are rolling out this approach that you heard from us,
yes,
what we can say for sure is that there is no major serious disease lurking in our country. That's for sure. If I look at the data that comes from Ayushman Bharat PMJ, where 40% of Indians are accessing the system, we have not seen any red flags.
Okay,
if you look at routine mortality numbers that are coming up, no. If you look at anecdotal reports of how the hospitals are telling us, they are not seeing any excess serious infection.
That's very,
so for sure,
that's
there
very
is no
reassuring.
Serious disease. But then there's another one.
But wait,
that's right. Of course, remember.
Touch wood.
Remember that there is a, that it is, I would like to very very seriously and very responsibly like to assure that there is no major serious COVID disease in terms of serious form of disease.
Okay, Dr. Paul, that's very reassuring.
The way we are being strategic, are we missing mild disease? Those numbers may be there.
Okay.
Those limitations are well known.
That's very reassuring.
Mild disease is a mild disease, should not worry us.
Okay, thank you so much for that. I think I have time just very quickly to just go to Kiran Shaw for a final word, Kiran Shaw, on the economic intervention at this point, because the Prime Minister mentioned the task force, but what would you actually like to see? Because as I mentioned, several governments have actually committed billions of dollars as stimulus. Do you think that that's something India needs to consider?
Well, I think, you know, we have to first look at various strata of our economic society, because if you look at the daily wage laborer, we look at the, the lower income, people in our workforce, the middle income. We have to look at stratifying our economic needs.
Yeah.
And I think we'll have to come up with different sort of, stimulus packages for each level.
Right.
You know, how do we make sure that the daily wage laborer is not out of money? How do we make sure that the lower and middle income people are not put to great, grief because of the maybe loss of jobs?
Right.
How do we prevent loss of jobs? How do we make sure that employers don't, just basically lay off people? You know, these are the kind of things. I mean, look at just the aviation industry. You know, they are the worst hit. Now, how are they going to? They've already been talking about, their salary cuts or even layoffs. Now, that's going to impact them a lot. So those are some of the sectors have to urgently be dealt with. There are many other sectors which don't need this kind of help, because I think many of them can work from home. Maybe the critical jobs are going to be the ones working, at their place of work.
Right.
But having said that, companies are definitely looking at making sure there are not too many people, who are at one place at one time. All these measures are being taken.
Okay,
so
I think
look at what the stimulus package is going to be for
every kind
of sector.
Okay, I think we'll have to leave it there, but that's a very important point you made, that it's really not so much about, in a sense, white-collar India, which is only a small layer of the economic pyramid. It's all those millions and millions of people below the chain who really now need to be addressed. And we do hope that the government will be looking at that. But thank you all very much indeed for joining us. We'll have to leave it there. But do continue to watch NDTV. We will continue to focus on this big story and bring you more reactions to the Prime Minister's address. Thanks for watching.